Hello, hello, everybody. This is Miss Rosa. We are going live today with Dana from Mexico. She's actually from Mexico. She's Latina, 100% Latina. And she's going to be my guest today. It's actually been a little bit, maybe a week and a half, maybe a few weeks that I have done a live. Hi, Aneudi. Thank you for watching. So I'm just waiting for Dana to go on. But just, this is, again, something that I do, a platform of just bringing people who look like us, who experience real situations like us, and you know, we can actually relate to them. So that's a good thing. Let me just snowball. Okay. And just hearing the truth from people, real people like us, I think actually, one, we can learn from them, and two, you know, we get to learn about the world, because Dana, my guest, she's actually from Mexico, so I know that people from different areas and different continents actually go through different situations. So here we go. She's actually gonna join us right now. Hi, Dana. Can you hear me?
Hi.
How are you?
Hi, my friend. How are you, amiga?
Estoy bien. ¿Cómo estás?
Bien. No me podía conectar y tengo todo preparado desde temprano y eso. Y dije, madre santa, nunca me había pasado. Y ya pude entrar.
Well, that's good. Well, we're already live. So we're live. We're like live on YouTube and everything. So thank you for doing this again. And nice to see you. You look so beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Nice weather here in Mexico, Cabo San Lucas.
Cabo San Lucas. And where is it again that you in Los Cabos? Is that part of the north or where is it in a map? So if people who are watching, they can actually understand where you are.
Okay. First of all, hello to all of your audience. And thank you, Rosa, for inviting me. I'm in Mexico, so I live on the tip of the Baja Peninsula. So it's Baja California Sur. So let's say, you know, like the state of US, California, then we have Northern Baja California, and then all the way down to the peninsula, it's the tip of the Baja, and that's where I am. And it's very, it's a tourist town, it's very warm, it's like, it's paradise. You have to come and visit.
I know. I was going to say where you live, because I watch your videos and sometimes when you go live too, I'm like, you live in a really good area of Mexico, you know, especially if it's a tourist area. And I know that a lot of people from America, I guess, you know, like we can see that we hear all these bad things about Mexico, but just like every country, there is good places too. It's not always bad, you know what I mean? So I think you live in a good area in Mexico, so that's awesome.
Yeah, no, you know what, I've traveled through the United States and Canada. It's here, Mexico is like any place in the world. If you're gonna go and be reckless and party really late and hang out with the wrong people, yes, well, difficult things happen. And of course, Mexico, there's bad things and there's corruption. I mean, but it's also everywhere. I am very defensive, not defensive, but you know, about when they say things about Mexico, one of the things that we see is that the quality of life is really nice. Mm-hmm. And you can live here with a quarter of what it's cost in any other place, like in the States. Mm-hmm. So also it's about tourism and that the money is not going somewhere else, because here in Mexico we have a very good quality. Of course, we have the towns in like in Sinaloa and places like that that they're not very safe, but it's not everywhere.
Yeah, no, and so let's wind up a little bit. So just so okay. that, because you, I know that I ask you where, you know, where you from and what part in Mexico, so that people could understand where you live. But just like a little background of how I know Dana. So throughout this whole entire COVID-19, we actually together, we've been, she's been watching Gary V Live too. And from Gary V Live, we've been able to actually create and find new individuals who actually think the same. For those that don't know Gary V, I think you guys should just go and Google Gary V. You should go on social media and just find out who he is. And I think that you will find so many things that are going to uplift you, and from what he says, you know, how he lives life and how he actually is helping us all to, you know, just look at the positive in life instead of looking at the negative, right? So through this whole thing, I actually was watching Gary V Live, and from Gary V Live, we actually met through Coach Jay, which I actually did. He was one of my guests in here too. And we just started talking. I remember just having a one-on-one conversation, like without, you know, anybody else being around. But what really I really like about you was the fact that I can relate to you, because one, you're Latina. Two, you also have gone through, you know, struggles in life, and the fact that you haven't allowed life to put you down is actually another reason why I really like, I like the way you, you know, who you are as an individual and as Dana, because we've all gone through many difficult situations, but some people, you know, are able to overcome them, and some people might need other people to, you know, to just learn from and maybe make it out in life and not make excuses for why things are happening in the world, you know, why things are happening to them and stuff like that. So that's how we met. That, and I know that we've had like a few conversations, and we follow each other on social media, and we support each other. And I like that we support each other. And you're like so pretty. Like, okay, one of the things, I know I have so many probably young women and even in general women, I'm a pretty simple person. Like, I don't even wear makeup, as you can see. But when I like to wear makeup, I actually like to wear like my lipstick, eyeliner. But that's basically what I wear. What is it that you wear? Because it's relatable to many of us.
Well, because here I live in a tropical weather, I can't use a lot of makeup because it will be, it'll look horrible, like pancakes. So what I do really look after is like my skin, that is always nourished and all that stuff. And I use very light foundation. And then from friends of mine, makeup artists, I learned how to apply kind of like a little bit of, you know, to make this thing and
lipstick. Said,
like lip gloss. Like, I don't, you see my drawer. I just have a very simple drawer with my makeup. I don't have much. And then what I really like is I buy some like a serum for my eyelashes, and I've seen how much they've grown. Yeah. So it's just, and I buy everything at Costco.
That's cool. It's okay. You know, like, and this is the thing, this is what I like. And what I really want to like say to people is like, what we're doing here is all real. You know what I mean? It's not like people trying to be something that they're not. It's sharing reality and just sharing the truth, because one, I feel like there's so many people out there who just want to hear real people, realistic people, you know, they don't want to hear the fake stuff, because the fake stuff is not cute sometimes. And a lot of the times it can get people in trouble for that. But I can see like you're wearing like a smoky eye, which actually looks pretty nice on you.
Oh yeah, I have a palette, and I just have learned how to do it. Yes, a little bit. I am wearing that too, but that's it. Yeah.
What's your favorite color of lipstick? Like,
I have like a nude color, and I apply two, like the lipstick and the lip gloss, but I really like red. I'm going out, I love red and the hoops. That's kind of my
I know
trait.
I was gonna say the hoops are real. Like, we cannot go anywhere without the hoops, right? These are so cool. I love them. I don't like them too big, but this is like perfect size, like for me.
Oh girl, I have them like that size, that size, that size. I don't know. I love the loop earrings.
Yeah, that's cool. That's good. Yeah, I was gonna say the lipstick too. I like red. Like, red is my favorite. And you're right, to make it like look, because I actually like the new style where I don't even know what it's called. Maybe somebody else can let me know, but where you just put it on and it looks almost like dry.
And yes,
it's not like shiny. I mean, it's shiny, but it's not shiny where, like, if you touch anything, it will come off. It's the lipstick that actually stays on. So I like those ones because, you know, we have to eat. And when we eat tacos, right? We eat tacos.
Yeah.
I just have it all over.
You're like, you're so cute.
I actually found out that women in general, because we wear makeup, like lipstick, we eat like 7 pounds of makeup, like lipstick.
Okay. I did not know that one.
Yeah. And I was just like, maybe we do a lot more eating than actually just, you know, putting it on and taking it off.
I know, it's fat free. I hope. I'm kidding.
It's fat free. That's so funny. That's a good one. I don't think there's stuff that's fat free, but it's not even good for you. So I'd rather wear like real, like organic stuff and stuff like that. So, but I do have a few questions for you. Okay.
Of course.
So you said, so you already answered one of the questions, but where is it that you live again?
I live in the tip of Baja California Sur, Mexico. So the Baja. Mm-hmm. Yes. Everybody knows about the famous arch in Cabo San Lucas, and they built a building in front of my house. They were not supposed to go that high because we were supposed to have like our view not blocked. Mm-hmm. But that, it's just here. Like, I can take a drive to the beach in 10 minutes. I'm there. It's very close. So
that's cool.
The arch, it's so beautiful here.
Oh my gosh, I would love to be right there because I love the beach. I love the beach.
Oh, cool. I have to be by the water, by the ocean.
And it's the ocean water is like very clean, right? And clear.
It is very clean. So this is a very peculiar place in the world because we have the Pacific Ocean, and in front of my house, in front where I am is the Pacific Ocean and it the Sea of Cortez. Mm-hmm. That's where they meet. Okay. So you have very cold water and then getting into the Gulf of Mexico. Jacques Cousteau, he used to call the Gulf of Mexico the aquarium of the world. So this is where all the whales come and have their babies. It's so rich in so much sea life. And then here the fishing is amazing because we have all the big predators, like all the big billfish from the Pacific that they come and feed here.
Wow. And
so it's really nice. We have some beaches here that is swimmable, not all of them, because the current is very, very rough. And then the beach drops very, like the beach, and then it makes a big drop. So there's some, people have to be careful.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, I was gonna say, and that's actually pretty simple, something good to like even share and talk about too, because some people say, well, it's the beach, but you know, the ocean, you can just go swimming. No, like you really have to, even great swimmers, they can actually drown because of the current and you know how strong the ocean is that it can just take you away. So that's actually pretty good too. It's always good to know the rules and what you can and cannot do, and you should just not go to Mexico and show off and be like, oh, I can swim, and then you just, you know, you're not paying attention to signs and directions and things that are telling you to be able to have be able to live your life, you know, and not drown or something happen to you. So that's something good to know. But living by the ocean, oh my gosh, like even that palm tree right now, like I'm jealous of you right now because I would love to be around the palm tree right now. It's awesome.
Well, you're going to come. I just wanted to mention something about here in Cabo that not a lot of people know, but we are very, very proud of it. We are blue certified, that all the beaches here are the cleanest beaches in all of Latin America.
Wow.
So it's, I want to remember, I just did a show on this about the certification. So they come from, it's a worldwide group association, and they're based in Mexico City. So they come here randomly and they take samples like of the ocean water, the sand, everything. So there's no pollution. There's like, even if you don't even see a cigarette butt, you and don't smoke, that's not good. Yeah. So they look after the beaches here. So it's very interesting. They're very clean.
That's really good. That's really good. And I was going to say, even too, with the beaches and water and the way society, it's actually likes to use a lot of plastic and a lot of things like that, you know, that they're saying that it by the year 2024, there's going to be more garbage in the oceans than fish. You know what I mean? And that statistics is actually pretty, I mean, it's accurate, but I think some people just think, I'm not going to make a difference if I just, you know, if I stop using plastic. But I feel like if it's a community, it's people, like more people get together, because only one person, only a few people taking that action where they're reducing to use plastic and throwing garbage everywhere or anywhere they go, they really just don't understand how you're impacting the world that you are living for your children, you know, with my son or even your grandchildren. Like, the ocean is life, you know, and I feel like more people should take more responsibility in a way that, you know, we should all do our part. If we all do our part, if we all work together, we can change situations like that. But the fact that there's gonna be more garbage in the ocean than fish by 2024, that's crazy. I don't like that.
It is. And here in Cabo, in Los Cabos, what I've seen is that there's a lot of young people like yourself that have projects about recycling and doing things. In my case, 4 years ago, I tried to go as less plastic as I can. I always have my containers. If I go to a coffee shop, I have my favorite ones that I take. Somebody said to me one time, if it has a commercial or if you have to open it from my package, try not to eat it. I think it was one the lady that my nutritionist that did that. So here, like half an hour from here, we have a place called Pescadero, and it's it's a place where there's a lot of farming and organic farming, because here we're a small town. We're 250,000 people here between Cabo San Lucas and San Lucas. We're divided by a road that's like 35 kilometers in between us. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's called Los Cabos.
Yeah.
And this place, so there's all this farms that they bring to your house in a wooden crate. For 500 pesos, that's kind of like $20. Mm-hmm. They bring you for 2 weeks, like all the vegetables, everything that you can consume. Wow. Then we have the ocean. So when there's fishermen coming in, they give a lot of the deck hands and their captains part of what they have caught. And sometimes you can buy it from them. So you're having like fresh fish from a sporting boat. So that's kind of like the lifestyle that we have here. And yes, there's a lot of people consuming like the water bottles and the soda pop bottles, and when it rains you can see down from the riverbanks how they're everything's being dragged to the ocean. There was a video, I'll look it up, there's a video that made me so sad by the arch that is so beautiful. It was just covered in plastic after one of the big hurricanes, big tropical storms that we have here. it was so dense and plastic, and you go like, how can that happen, right?
Yeah, even like with this whole COVID-19, like me and my boyfriend have been, you know, we take walks to the park and stuff like that. And lately we've been even noticing masks on the floor, just people throwing them on the floor. And I'm just like, do people just not think about how it's not affecting you right now? It's things like your actions, sooner or later, whether they're positive or negative, they're going to have a repercussion. You know what I mean? And I feel like even that part of it, I think that we can do a lot better. And if anybody is listening and watching, I just want to encourage you to just look at how you're acting when you are using plastic, or when you are throwing garbage, you know, like where is it that you're doing it and stuff like that, and try to be more mindful about it and not be so careless about it, you know? So I hope that changes soon. But where did you grow up? Because were you always there where you at now or not?
No. I decided to come here full time 11 years ago. I was born in a little town called Mexico City, 35 million people.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. But when I was around 5-6 years old, my dad had a job offer and we moved up north. Okay. So we went to Mexicali. That's a small town by the border, by Calexico. And it's one of the warmest places in Mexico. It's like, it's a desert, it's really warm. And then we moved to Tijuana, and to a little town called Playa de Tijuana, very similar, because we live very close to the ocean, and it's right next to San Diego, California.
Oh, nice.
It's beautiful. One of the, I say that, America's finest city, it's called.
And then the other question I was gonna ask you, so you grew up with both your parents together?
Yes, I did. Okay. Yes, I did.
So with that said, you know, so that means that you had two parents, you had, an education, right? As a young girl, you was able to go to college, I mean, to school. And were you even able to go to college too or no?
I did, but I could not finish because when I was very young and just started studying architecture, my dad was diagnosed with cancer, with bladder cancer, and with all the stress at home and the bills, everything. So I had to leave school and start working.
Wow.
So that was a awakening.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we'll go back to what you just said. And you know, like a lot of people can relate to what you just said, you know what I mean? But even me being from Guatemala, which is, you live in Mexico. I was born in Guatemala. Both countries are third world countries. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just the difference between me and you was at least able to have two parents and they try to give you an education and had enough, you know, I'm sure they were able to have enough income to be able to send you to school. Versus when I was born, I remember just being born, you know, living in the streets and being poor, very poor, where like, because my parents were alcoholics, my mom actually drank, my father drank, and, you know, they would be the ones that actually would be in the streets. You know, they would be just laying down in the streets. Like I was born close to Guatemala City too. And they were never able to send me to school. I never remember just having a stable home. I just always remember just living in the streets and actually trying to live and survive. And that's the difference between, you know, like in some way, like your life and my life, even though we both live in a third world country, I feel like it's almost like that's the two differences, right? Because there's really no in between middle class. There's either poor or rich, you know, like people who actually can send their kids to school and actually have a home and actually do, you know, have an opportunity to work. And you know, that's what I mean. That's what I mean when I say it's a third world country. My country is very poor. A lot of it's if you're born without money, that's how you was born. There's nothing that can change that. You know what I mean? Unless like me, I was given an opportunity to go to an orphanage finally and actually get adopted, come here to America, take the opportunity to actually learn English and my education. And this is why we're standing right here together, you know? But I know that a lot of people can relate to you and can relate to me when it comes to, I didn't have a choice where I was born and what was given to me. However, I did choose to do the right thing when I came here to America to be able to take that opportunity and become better and break the cycle of not having an education, not becoming an alcoholic, or, you know, becoming an addiction to drugs or anything like that. And I'm blessed for that. And even with you, I know that you just said it, that your father was diagnosed with cancer, which, you know, I'm sorry to hear that, but do you want to explain how that hardship, because I was going to ask you, could you share two different experiences where life taught you how to find a way out? You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. We are survivors. And like yourself, like, you're so inspiring, Rosa. Since the day I first met you and I heard your story, is that you were able to become the best version of you and not have an excuse and say, like, I'm going to do this. And I follow you on Instagram. And I've been taking care of myself better, like with vitamins and supplements and everything. You know, now I go and do my hikes. So it's how we are all connected. Like, yeah. You, my mom, she was an orphan. Her mom passed away when she was born. And so she doesn't have a memory of her mom. Then her dad passed away when she was still very young and had to move to her grandmother's house, mm-hmm. where the thing that she said to her, like, okay, your dad died, but you have one day to cry all you want. Tomorrow you go to school. And then my mom would hear things like, I already raised my kids and now I'm stuck with you. So my mom at 18 years, no, I think she was younger. She said she started working because she said she was 18, but she was younger and started working. Yeah. Like back then, my mom is 80 years old. Back then, there were not so many, there were not computers or anything. Yeah. So what you put in your application, I guess that she got away with it. But yes, like, so that's why my mom, being an orphan, I think that she really looked after me and education and taught me how to have as many tools in my life as I could, because you never know what's going to happen. And I remember my mom's a very loving mom. And when we were kids, she would always kind of like pamper us and do things, because my mom says, when you're in my house and I'm able to do this for you, I will do it, mm-hmm. because I didn't have that. And I don't know what life is going to bring to your life that you might not have this again or like won't have it for a long time. So that's how it was. So yeah, like I grew up in a normal home and went to school, and like it was just kind of like normal. But when I heard the news that my dad was diagnosed with cancer, that was kind of like when everything changed for me, because like I felt that little protection bubble or that thing, like everything, the ground that I was, my solid ground, it was just pulled away. And I saw my dad, how cancer really took a toll on his body and his spirit. Because like I was very young, and he passed away at 52 years old.
Wow.
He was very young, and so he wanted to do more things, and he was a very positive person. But my dad, he grew up in Second World War in Spain, and my dad was born in 1938. And so Second World started at 39. Maybe I already went so far away, but this was one of the diagnoses that the doctor said. My dad had been so malnourished mm-hmm. since a baby that mm-hmm. through the years that also took a toll on his body. So wow. it deteriorated a lot faster. Yeah.
Wow. So you mm-hmm. think that had like is that what the doctor really said, that malnourishment?
It had to do a little bit of everything, a little bit to do of everything. So, that's when I started going into the world and working and just trying to set up, make a path for my life. But it was difficult. But then you go like, well, you accept your situation, and you say like, there's a lot of people that gone through this or even worse, and mm-hmm. I just can't do it, and then it's a growing, right? Growing yeah. experience.
Growing mm-hmm. experience. Yeah. So that was one hard experience that you, even though you was young and you still had the opportunity to grow up, is I feel like a lot of kids here, even in America, you know, they might be going through some hard situations, but just like you and me, like you, like your dad, you know, was sick to the point that you had to stop going to school mm-hmm. so that you can start working, so that you can start helping with the bills or whatever it is that you guys needed, because your dad was not able to provide that anymore or do that anymore. So in that sense, I feel like you was not like a spoiled, you know, like a spoiled kid where
oh God, no.
you'd be like, man, why did this happen?
Oh no.
Getting mad or getting upset, because I know, even though you say, you know, like, oh no, like I know that some people will be like, they wouldn't think of a situation like that. They will think of more, is a, you know, like my dad, it's actually passing away. I need to do what it is that I need to do. But most people would be like just thinking in a selfish way, you know what I mean? And you took it as a soldier, and was like, even though I'm a young girl and I know I still have an opportunity to finish school, I have to do what I have to do, and I cannot make excuses for life, right? I cannot say, well, poor me, poor. No, you just did what you had to do. And I think life teaches that a lot, you know, to many people.
Yes, no, I never grew up spoiled. Like my dad and my grandmother, they would always tell us stories when they were in a concentration camp. Like mm-hmm. in my house, no, not nada de comida, not any food could go rotten. Mm-hmm. You would eat whatever they put in your plate, you would eat it. And we grew up with a lot of discipline. And I grew up hearing my dad saying, like, I didn't have that when I was your kid, when I was your age. And I wish that I would have all those opportunities. And so basically that's what I grew up listening to. And then my mom, I remember one time I really wanted something. And this is another story that really changed my life. And then like when I wanted something, and my mom said, well, when I was your age, I already work and pay for my own clothes. Mm. So when you have parents like that, that they're so strong and they have gone through so many things, you as a kid, maybe you didn't go through all the things that they did, but it's an effect that stays with you in your life, because it's also, I think it's also in your biological life, in tu biología, mm-hmm. that, because you come from them, right? And yeah. and their spirits came from situations very difficult. So I remember, Rosa, that, well, I used to go to a school. Both of my parents worked very hard and they wanted to give us the best education. And I went to a private school, and I had some friends that they were very wealthy. Like one of my friends, her grandfather owned 2 or 3 hospitals. And so when you're a teenager and you're seeing that your friends are having the, you know, like the brand new car and they're the cool clothes, and
cool,
you're kind of like
cool sneakers, and you, cool backpack, cool everything, right? Yeah.
Exactly. So I had some money and I went to a fancy name brand store and got designer eyeglasses, uh-huh. like sunglasses. And when I came home, I'd never seen my dad so upset. he said, you know how much I have to work for, to be able to afford that? And he says, I think it's time for you to understand the value of a dollar.
Wow.
And he put me behind an office to start answering phone calls. So I would go to work, I would go to school, and then I would help around in the afternoons and in an office. And that's how I started to learn real estate, because that, you know, I'm a real estate agent. So when people say, like, how did you start? Like, hello, may I help you?
Experiences from life. And I just want to stop there, because like that moment, and just clarify too, okay, that you actually had parents who, instead of, you know, because you felt bad that, you know, you wanted something to look just like all the other teenagers who had brand names and brands, sneakers, or, you know, and I think it's part of nature for all of us to feel like that. But the biggest take in that is that having mm-hmm. a family member who is going to tell you straight up how it is. Like, now, even with me, I don't care about clothes. I don't care about brand. As long as it fits well in my feet, I'm good. As long as it looks good on me, I'm good. It doesn't have to be brand, but I just feel like a lot of us need to grow up not, even young kids now, like that I work with, having the nicer things and just going for that, always spending all your money instead of investing it, instead of looking for something that's gonna give you value later on in life, or in education, that you're going to learn how to build a business and go through that stuff. I think that's something more important for you to spend your money on than something so like materialistic. That is
exactly,
you're never gonna take it with you. It's never gonna help you. You know what I mean? Having just a few things, nice things, okay, no problem, because we all want those nice things, those nice brand, I guess. But I don't think that really makes a person. What really makes a person is what's in your heart. You know what I mean? How you treat mm-hmm. people, how you keep learning from the experiences from life. And, you know, even with me, like I remember in Guatemala dreaming of having headphones for the first time. Mm-hmm. So when I came here to America and it was Christmas and I actually got my headphones for the first time, like a CD player and headphones, I was so happy. I never looked at, like, I never knew anything about brand, like Gucci and all, Louis Vuitton or anything like that. All I was just happy at the fact that I had what I wanted for a long time, and it worked. So I always look, I was always happy with just the simplest thing, because I remember not having nothing in life, you know? So that part where your parents, your dad saw that, he actually taught you something at an earlier age that I feel like a lot of kids nowadays don't get taught. You know what I mean?
It was a breaking moment in my life when I understood how many hours I had to be working and on time and be professional or whatever at that age to be able to afford that. Yeah. And I really respected the value of money. So that's going back for when we started our conversation about Gary Vee. This is one of the things why I follow him so much, and I have built my brand on his advice, on a lot of his content. Like, I don't care to buy name brand things, or that I have the tag here, or if I have, I don't care to keep up with the Joneses. Mm-hmm. I, like you say, if it's comfortable, if it's sometimes cute, why not? Mm-hmm. But I prefer to invest those things in my education, yep, self preparing, maybe a nice trip, build my home. Like, I was able to build my home and paid in full in 3 years. And I don't owe a dime on this home. Wow. But the thing is that I did not even buy myself a cup of coffee. You know, like, I didn't stop at Starbucks or anything. And since I was a kid, I always learned how to hustle. Yeah. Like, I was the kid who would sell Hello Kitty stickers to my friends, or I like to paint and I would write their, charge them like a quarter, and I would write their names and put a lot of colors. Mm-hmm. So I always like to make my own way. And so that has helped me. And since I don't have to pretend to be somebody that I'm not, or I don't need to show off to anybody, anybody can come here to mi casa, tu casa.
Yeah.
And I'm very proud, because maybe it's not the fanciest home here, but it's a home, and it's something that it was built.
That you're proud of. Yeah, that you're proud of. And that you have created something that maybe if your life would have turned out differently, which a lot of kids, you know, a lot of families in Mexico who live in a poor areas, they don't have anything like that. Like, they would love to have the earrings that you and I have, you know, like, mm-hmm. even orphan kids, they would love to have, like, I mean, they have nice hair, but the clothes, the dress, you know, the lipstick, or even just the mascara and stuff like that, they would love to have that, but they were not born in a place where they are given that opportunity. And I think that even with that said, I feel like you and your situation with your dad, you and your mom could have just made excuses to not make it in life. You understand? To always say, poor me, in a way that you live in poverty for the rest of your life, because your father was not there anymore. But you guys have a strong mindset, and you guys had a strong heart, and that motivation inside of you that allow you to say, no, we're gonna hustle. We are going to do whatever it takes so that we can make it, and we can make it comfortable for ourselves, not for anybody else, because you're making it for you so that you can be happy with yourself. You know what I mean?
Oh, I totally understand what you mean, Rosa. And also, I have learned how to enjoy the process.
Yeah.
You have a goal, but the process, and that step by step. When I'm saying that I need to make a pause and explain, here in Mexico, to have a mortgage, or our interest rates, they're crazy high. It could be up to 13%. Like in the States, sometimes they're 1 or 2%. So mm-hmm. just comparison. So basically, when you purchase a house here, it has to be cash. Wow. So for me to able to build this in 3 years, just by dedication and discipline and like not spending and having the same runners, or having a couple of cute dresses to go in showings, and that's it. But now, like when the pandemic hit, and I'm going like, oh my God, I'm in my own house. I don't have to worry about anything else. And it's fine just like it is right now. But like, I have had two times in my life that I have had to reinvent myself.
Mm.
And one helped me to be stronger to the next one, right? One was when I was 19 years old, that my dad passed away,
mm-hmm.
and not a lot of experience. My mom and I said, okay, we are a team, we're going to do this. And we kept on growing and working. Work for me has been my lifesaver. So I didn't, because like I didn't get into drugs or alcohol or making dumb decisions.
You was not bored to make those decisions. And I feel like a lot of kids who are born, that's what they end up turning into, because they need something exciting. They need something to do. They need, you know, so anything is inviting to them. So you was able to work to get yourself out of that, you know, not get yourself into those situations, right?
I've always liked motivation and like spiritual speakers. So now with YouTube, like you can have access to so many. But mm-hmm. When I was 19 years old, like back in the 90s, you would have books and authors, and I would read, and my mom also loves to read. So I've always tried to fill myself with positive information, and also important who you hang out with.
Yes.
That it's key. If you have friends that they're
They're smoking. Like, let's keep it real. Let's keep it real, girl. So they're smoking, they're drinking, they are, you know, mm-hmm. they're into drugs, or they are, you know, thinking that the cool is to go and do things that are not going to keep you safe and keep you and give you a long life, then that's you, then that's not where you should be, you know, even
exactly.
though it feels exciting, even though you're young and it's exciting, you just definitely want to start choosing a different path for yourself, for sure.
And I'm gonna be so like very honest, like I don't have a halo or anything like that. I've made a bunch of mistakes and bad decisions in my life, like really bad. Like in Mexico, in my time, it was very popular to smoke. Mm. And like when you're in high school, we would just smoke. And that's a horrible habit. Or I've been partying out and have had way too much to drink and yeah. make some mistakes or like things like that. But you learn and you bounce back and you get back into track. And my second time, and I think it was my hardest, is I got married very young, very young. And then I was married for 15 years. And after 15 years, I decided to ask for a divorce. Mm-hmm. That thing that I thought it was going to be a lot easier than it was. It took me almost 2 years to be able to get divorced. And that's how I moved to Cabo San Lucas. Because well, like...
And with that, I just want you to, like, I don't know if you feel comfortable, but I just that the more realistic that we are about it, about our situation and our experiences, the better I think we can reach, you know, people can understand you and actually say, wow, I look at her now versus look at how she was going, you know, what she went through and why she mm-hmm. here. You know what I mean?
I'm an open book. And every time that I do my videos or my radio show, I'm an open book. You know, Rosa, I'm not going to take anything from this life. And I was not able to be a mom that I would have loved to be a mom mm-hmm. of five kids. That's how I envisioned myself, that I was going to be that mom, soccer mom and minivan and all that stuff, because I'm very maternal. Mm-hmm. So if my experience, this is why I'm so passionate to sharing all of this. If my experience can help somebody else, just saying like, oh, if she did it, she could do it, maybe I can. I have nothing special. I'm yeah. just a regular person that I didn't think that I was that strong. And in certain circumstances in my life, something inside me just comes out. And I think that it's very spiritual. I think that it's something that just saves me and pulls me out and gives me the strength to be coming back again. And mm-hmm. when I moved here to Cabo, that after my divorce, and I mean, I married a person that we live a very, very comfortable life. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was going to be exactly the same, but I didn't realize that no, now I was on my own. I moved here to Cabo and I didn't even know how to pay my electric bill. Mm. Like, and then I ran out of money because mm-hmm. my mentality was in my life from 15 years.
Past. Yeah, in
from
the past.
The past.
Of where and, you was comfortable and you was being taken care of in some way, you know, mm-hmm. in some way. And actually, instead of staying in that relationship, because you found out that it wasn't healthy for you, you moved into the unknown. And the unknown at this point is you don't have the comfortable home anymore, but you chose your happiness and you and who you are as an individual to go into the unknown and try to make it there.
Exactly. That's why I'm so proud of the things that I've been able to pass and to live. I'm very proud of all those experiences because I moved to Cabo that I didn't know anybody. And then I had to get that thing at how am I going to make money? How am I going to pay my rent or put gas in my car? So to go into that set of mind, then that's in 2009 that I moved here. That was when the flu thing happened. Not so hard like this one, but everything, tourism, there was no business here. So this is the thing that somebody asked me one day, like if there was a nanny, because there's a lot of Americans and Canadians that come here on vacation, and Kabul has a very big business about the vacation rentals. Mm-hmm. So they asked me if I knew anybody that would look after children. And I went like, let me ask. And so what do you need? Well, if they're bilingual, that would be awesome, and this and that. And I couldn't find anybody that would suit that around here. And then I went like, damn, I need the money. How much do you pay? And he said, well, we pay this much an hour. And I said, okay, I can take care of the kids. And that's how I started my business that was able for me to stay here for 2 years. I will look after children like during Thanksgiving, not Thanksgiving, but during the Thanksgiving holidays. Mm-hmm. And where the parents want to go and have dinner or have some drinks out of the town. Mm-hmm. So I would look after kids and all those fancy residences that they were for rent here. And
so
people
So you being bilingual actually helped you.
Oh my God, it did.
And that's what I was going to say. You knowing English and Spanish. So for a lot of our young viewers who actually speak Spanish and English or any other language, always keep your original language, because speaking two languages and more actually can help you on in later on in life, just like Dana is explaining right now. I think that's cool. The fact that you was able to get a job just like that, because you speak, you know, you're bilingual too.
Yeah. And I didn't tell you how I was bilingual. It's because when we moved to Tijuana is on the northern tip. I live now on the southern tip of Baja, and Tijuana is on the northern tip next to San Diego. So everything, we didn't get Mexican television or Mexican radio or anything, because we were so far away from the center of Mexico. So all of our TV, everything was in English. So by watching TV and listening to the radio, that's how I picked up English so fast.
Wow. And it's good advice for everybody. Don't make excuses. Don't make excuses, because you can watch videos, you can watch YouTube videos, you can just listen to just on TV, you can watch something in Spanish and start learning your Spanish.
If you ask me how to write, I'm not a very good speller, but just by listening, I was able to pick up English. And when I came here to Cabo, here, all of our tourism is mostly from North America. Yeah. So you speak sometimes more English during the day than Espanol. So I saw that, Rosa, as an opportunity. And that's how my network, Ask Dana, or my brand, Ask Dana, started. Because people would say like, hey, we just purchased a house and we need our air conditioners to be served, and we need a mechanic, and we need all of this. So I would go into town with my business cards on foot. I didn't have a car, and I would go everywhere. And boy, my feet were so swollen, and I was so tired by the end of the day, because people still remember me walking from one place to the other, giving my business cards and asking, could you please recommend this person? So I started knowing a lot of people here from the results they would give on their work. So mm-hmm. Now when I recommend somebody that I've known for 11 years, and I know they're going to be, so that's how the network that I created started. And then every day I would go to work, I would find opportunities. I have that sense of where the trends are going and where should I kind of like go, and continue selling my real estate and start doing better on sales. And then when I started watching Gary Vee, not watching Gary Vee, I was listening to a podcast and somebody said, Crush It by Gary Vee. So I downloaded from Audible, listened to the book, and I go like, interesting. So that's how I started Mexico Home and Life, the radio show. And
yeah, I was gonna say, I was in your radio show, which is awesome. Yes. And the fact that you were able to, even as a woman too in Mexico, right? Because women are not so looked at as valuable, you know what I mean? And our countries, you know, your country and Mexico and even in Guatemala, like women get beaten, you know, they get beaten. And I know that it's a very like almost machismo type of way.
Oh God, yes.
And
yes.
When I say machismo, meaning like the man is the one that makes all the decisions, the woman's value, the what she says is not, you know, it's not valuable, it's not taken seriously. So a woman basically is good for being in a relationship, having kids, taking care of the kids, cooking, cleaning, and that's it, nothing else. Because I mean, I remember even my father in Guatemala, he always hit my mother too. And I never felt like men really had like that respect for women and the value of what it means to be a woman. So the fact that you have become so successful, even in Mexico, as a woman too, and found your way out, it just shows that in life or in the world, you can, yes, you might not choose, like for me, I didn't choose where I was born, but if there is an opportunity for you to do better, always try that opportunity in a way that take your education seriously, take that, you know, like with you watching the kids, the nanny, take that seriously, because you never know where that is going to take you in life. And all experiences are going to make you a better individual and a better human being and get you to where you want to go. So even with you, Dana, I'm like super proud of you as being Latinas, because you, even though it seems like, well, you know, I'm supposed to make it, not a lot of people is able to make it like you and I, you know what I mean? So I appreciate all the things that you've been going through and sharing, and just look at you now. You're like, you have a radio show too. People are working with you. You're able to have experiences that a lot of people might not be able to.
But you know, I understood that my circumstances, they were there to teach me a lesson. And this is part of the message that I always want to put out. So I wish that I would have heard it when I was at that age struggling. There's going to be days that it's not going to be fun getting up out of your bed and going to work. And there's going to be some days that you just knock it out of the ballpark. And yeah, those days too, you have to be very level. Okay, what, and just review, how far have I gotten? What did I do today so I can repeat it? And write, keep a journal, keep yeah, something that keeps you. So when you go back, like I have a journal the other day, and I, when I started my other notebook, and I go like this date on 2015, I was in tears when I was reading that mm-hmm, when I was writing some of those things in my journals, I didn't think that I was gonna make it.
Yeah. And we all go through those struggles too, where we're just, I mean, and what you're saying about the journal, I do the same thing. There's some days too that I read back in the journals that I've written, and I'm like, wow, I was so negative. Wow, I was so like down. I was crying, but to me, I'm not like that anymore. So there is some parts that I read that I'm like, that was pretty bad, but there are some parts that just give me encouragement, because I'm like, look at me now, like I actually feel so much better. I actually have grown into a whole different person too. That's not me. Like when I was from now to when I was a kid too, I used to curse at my journal. And that's what I tell a lot to my kids, you know, the young kids. I was like, if you need an outlet, if you don't know what's, you know, how to, nobody's listening to you and you need something, just listen to one, your favorite music, two, write things down, write your feelings, even if it's swearing and cursing, that notebook is not gonna do nothing to you. You're just letting all those emotions out, and then you're able to finally think and just say, okay, tomorrow's a new day, let me do better next day, you know what I mean?
And that's very healthy. And, you know, Rosa, we've talked about this. Also, I'm very involved here with the groups of women. and for me to help right now that there's a lot of violence too, because you know my story, and I know that we're almost on top of the hour, but like when I was a kid and I did not say anything to my mother, I had a family member that he was a very aggressive person and hit me all the time, like punch me, kick me on the ground, send me to the hospital more than a couple of times. And so that happens when I was from 5 to 15, when he finally left home and I was like, hey, life started.
Yeah.
So I really struggle with all of that self-love or self-confidence, because I used to mentally kind of like punish myself. And I felt very embarrassed that that happened to me. And I was able to speak about that 3 years ago. And last year on my radio show that we were doing a video, I said, I went through this. And the people, when we were live, they went like, what? Now I can talk about this. And now if there's a 9-year-old girl out there that your cousin or your brother or whoever is violent and hitting you right now, and you're afraid and just in the corner and just hoping that your mom doesn't go anywhere because that person's gonna hurt you,
yeah,
you need to speak. You need to tell somebody, because the person, the aggressor, will, when you have, you have to be brave. And I did a video on that, and I got a message from a kid, and she said like, I'm going through that. And I'm going, yeah, like, holy moly. So yeah, that's big. That's very big on my book. And that's something that I want to do that. I don't know how you say it in English, like a crusade on that.
To be an advocate or to.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I survived. And sometimes I thought that I was not going to make it. And I did, and I was able to pull out, and also like my relationships, I would always look for that boyfriend that he would be the strong figure, that he would protect me, and that was not sometimes the best choice.
Yeah,
right.
So what do you think is the best choice when choosing somebody for yourself, I guess, now with what you've been going through? It's a, you know, just even as general, like with our young ladies, you know, like a lot of times you just choose the man because he looks hot, or you're just in love with what is in the outside. But I feel like there is something about choosing a man that is right for you, meaning he's going to treat you right always. He's never gonna call you out of your names. He's never gonna put hands on you, and he's always making sure that you're really taken care of in a way that if you're sick, is he there for you, or is he leaving you, you know, to take care of by yourself? Does he take your relationship serious? And also, this is probably just even for the younger sessions, just remember, like when you pick a boyfriend right now, you might pick one that is not good for you, but you're still young to make that choice of, hey, if that person is not good for me, or is just not treating me right, you have so much time to not stay in that toxic relationship. Just say no, go and improve yourself, go and do what it is that you need to do for yourself, and just choose your happiness always over somebody else's happiness, because we put somebody else's happiness over ours, and that's why we take so much pain, right? And
we
take so much violent ways of certain people, or the words, you know, like verbal abuse, physical abuse, mental abuse, you know, there's all different type of abuse. So just be strong and just say no, you know what I mean? I actually went through it in some way, but I was actually strong enough to say no more.
You know what? Actions and actions speak louder than words. So just be attentive. Little details give you clues. And when you feel there's like a red light,
yes,
like, you know, like, it's just back up.
Listen to that. Listen to that instinct, right?
Yes, or not because somebody's gonna take care. Let me tell you, there's nothing more empowering and make you feel so comfortable and in entering it very good in a relationship when you are self-efficient.
Yes.
Because then you have your own. And I think that's one of the things really important that to be teach to young women, that you can make it on yourself. And one of the things that really, really I like from all the audiobooks and all of the videos I look mm-hmm. is that become very happy, be a fun person, just like be that you like hanging out with you and create all of this world that it's cool and just your world. Yeah. And then that person will come. Don't go looking for nothing, like for no one. That the right person will come and always try to have your spirits up and vibration, you know,
positive. Just being different. Because listen, before I used to probably care about even my eyebrows because they look so like bushy right now and even my hair looking a little bit better, but I'm like I'm different. I'm me. Like, I'm by myself. I actually have somebody who loves me for who I am. And I have my son that I'm actually trying to teach him to also be self-sufficient too, right? Because as young, we as parents have to do our part. And with Jojo, I'm already, like, he already knows how to cook. He knows how to do laundry. He knows how to make his room, like, neat and everything. So, like, and he's 10 years old. But it's something for me too that I have to teach him, and just at a younger age. And also love, I say, hey, if people are making fun of you or if people don't love you for who you are, then that's not about you. There's something going on with them in their life that's why they are treating you like that, or that's why they're saying things about you like that. But it has nothing to do with you. And I always try to reinforce that positivity so that he can share it with others.
It will go a long way. Your legacy with your son will go a long way, and it will be brought through generation to generation. It is the best thing that you're doing right now.
Thank you. Oh my gosh, this is awesome. But I actually want to have you again, you know, another time.
Let's...
I know it's in an hour, but I don't even care about the time like that, because this is a great conversation. I just feel like you actually are a good example to many young women, because you have lived life and you have experienced life in a way that you could have not be here. You could not have your radio station. You could not have an opportunity to own your own home. You could not have an opportunity to work with people from, you know, who speak English, because you chose to just, you know, put yourself in a bad situation where you're not learning that, you know, other languages to help you in your career and your future and as an individual. But I just feel like the fact that we both are Latinas, that's number one. And it's like, ooh, I'm super proud of being Guatemalan. I love being Latina. Me encanta que yo pueda hablar en español también. And I know that you do too. So I just feel like there's many of us, like, you know, there's many out there who want to be like us too, you know, in some way. And I just want to be like truthful, because I wish I had somebody like you when I was younger too, you know, because things happened to me when I was younger too, where I didn't say nothing. And I thought it was all about, you know, my phone. But I took it upon myself to just keep that pain inside of me, to keep those things inside of me. And if I would have listened to somebody like you and be like, wow, she actually spoke out, she actually, you know, made it and everything was okay, I could have taken those steps. But I feel like everybody's life is, in, you know, different. And just take your time. Just, I don't know, just be you. Always be you, no matter what. And don't care what anybody else says, right?
Yeah, and you know what? Like, life, it's just, it's like a laboratory. I don't know how to say it, because like every day something else comes and you have to learn, and you have two decisions. What is your attitude? towards any situation. Like I also read one day, it says, learn to be comfortable in uncomfortable situations. And I'm going to be like super honest too, like with all this pandemic and things happening, it has gotten to me because I go out and I have my mask on and I don't see a lot of people having their mask. And I want to say something like, hey, dude, put it on. Like, what's just, why not? You're not going to use it, right? So I've been here at my house. So what I did, Rosa, is that I went back to my journals and read everything. I needed that. I needed, again, another boost, because I think that in this situation, we have all of us reinvented myself. So now what I'm focusing is that listening to content like yours and like Coach Jay and Gary Vee and the people that are interviewed in his, and my coach that I love her so much, Samantha Buckley Hugenson. She wrote a book, it's called Unstuck Yourself. Mm-hmm. So I also, I don't read much anymore. I like to, when I'm hiking, listen. I like to listen, and that's how I better process things. So that's, I'm taking it just one day at a time, but always looking at positive content to put in my head and my spirit.
Yeah. And mm-hmm. you're saying, you know, that's right. Like even with this whole entire COVID-19 going on, I know that there is so many people who are struggling and we've lost jobs and, you know, but I feel like there is always, like you said, even though this whole thing is going on, I think that we have options. And if you have options, use those resources that you have to better yourself, to improve who you are. And, you know, like, what could you say to somebody, a girl who is feeling bored?
Oh my God, what?
Yeah, like,
who, sorry.
You know, in some way, like, bored meaning, like, they're, you know, their parents are still in charge, they're not old enough to work, they're not able to do much but to stay at home. You know what I mean? What
okay.
would you say to a girl like that?
That is a great question. Okay. What is your passion? What do you like? Do you like creating contact? Do you like to dance? Do you like music? Do you like to paint? Do you like to write poetry or whatever? I don't know poetry. People even write it anymore.
Yeah, poetry.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Or like I have some of my kids' friends that are really talented in the e-games.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and some people might say, oh, that's not a... Well, if there's their passion, do that. But create something that you are the first.
Yeah.
And when you are doing things like girls that they're so talented and so cute how they dance, maybe come up with a new song or a new beat or do something different, and everything just takes over. Like get those creative things, or like if I'm thinking more about like artistic things because I love all that. Or right now, I think there's a lot of opportunities for business. What business would you start, or with your friends, with your neighbors?
Writing it down, right? Because some people say, I don't have money, I can't work, I can't do this. So, you know, even you don't need money to be able to create a business at the beginning. You have to have that idea. You have to write it down. You have to do your research. You have to listen to people who are going to inspire you and to help you create that idea in a way that you want to create it and move forward with it. But you have to write it down first. And while that time is going on, eventually you'll become, you'll find ways to say, okay, who can help me out? Who can I work or who can I do like something, like whether it's cleaning houses, whether it's babysitting, who can I do something to get money here and there? You know what I mean? So that eventually all those things come, you know, they come to you, but just don't wait. Don't wait for nobody to, and don't wait for, I don't know, like to say, well, now is not the right time. Just,
oh God, right now is such a good time.
Yes.
Let me tell you just a quick story that I love. So I saw a post, a very normal, simple post on Facebook, and it talked about a groomer. So then another friend of mine, I saw that she posted that the girl had gone to her house and groomed her puppy. And she must be 18 years old, like basically just started driving or like her car. Mm-hmm. And because here in the hotel business, a lot of people are unemployed. It's amazing how many people are now with no jobs. So this girl went online, took the courses, learned how to, you know, groom the puppies, mm-hmm. comes to your house. She takes social distance. She parks. She has a very simple table. You provide like the, she just has the table, her sisters, and whatever equipment that she needs.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think she has invested more than $100, $120, I guess.
Yeah.
And she comes and I have 5 dogs and a cat. She grooms all of the puppies. So I have some neighbors here that I tag her and everything. We even did a TikTok together. So I told my neighbors and she says, oh, but I don't know, can I take your dog? So I have also the neighbor's dogs once a month, and she does here in the morning 6 dogs. That income is more than what she would make in a week.
And a regular job.
In a hotel.
Wow.
And so now
that's an example. That's a great
18 years old. $120 investment. And now, and all of our friends here in the neighborhood that we all know each other, like tag one and the other one and the other one. So now she has her routine. I have her book once a month that I know that on Friday, on the second week of Friday, she comes at 10 a.m.
Wow.
Open the gate. She drives and she takes all morning grooming the 6 dogs.
Wow, that's awesome. You see, that's amazing. That's what we need. And that's how we can help you, right? If you know people too, like Dana, she's going to help you. She helped this girl too to get more customers and everything like that. Just pull yourself out, but you have to do the work first.
And when I get messages, I love to answer messages. And like I'm on Instagram and Ask Dana TV. Send me a message if my 5 cents of advice or whatever can work for you. Uh-huh. Like, and I see, and right now with the Ask Dana Network, I'm going to business owners, and like I see sometimes they're not very savvy on their social, you know, like their
social media,
Facebook or social media. So I try to help them a bit and do a live and promote, and I'm filming how they prepare and how well they're looking after the sanitation and everything. Mm-hmm. So it's a way of giving back to the community and helping the local businesses, because video is very powerful.
Yes.
And when people can see what's behind, not just the post with the sandwich or whatever, you go back and you see the whole line, how they're building up the sandwich or whatever, the business. Yeah. So that's pretty nice.
Yeah, that's, I've seen you do that, and I think that's pretty cool too. So this is awesome. But thank you so much. I appreciate
it. Thank you, my darling.
Here, and I would love to be, you know, for you to come up again, and hopefully one day we'll be able to see each other and actually meet and hug each other. You know what I mean?
You have to come. Let me see if I can. Do you see the ocean?
Yeah.
I don't know, baby.
Let me see it. Yeah, I can see it from far. Yep.
Oh, yeah, there it is. There.
Sure.
Take a dive. Yeah. So yeah, come and visit us, and like here in Cabo San Lucas, Mexico. And thank you so much. And next time, I'll invite you on my platform.
Okay, no problem. This will be awesome. Okay. So thank you so much. Yes,
te quiero mucho. Bye, Rosa.
Okay.
And bye to everybody, and thank you.
Yes.
Thank you for the invitation.
We'll see you.
Bye.